हिंदी में एक कहावत है, जाना ना हो जहाँ वहीं जाता है दिल। दिल उल्लू का पट्टा है, फूटी तकदीर क्यों आजमाता है। दिल उल्लू का पट्टा है। हियर उल्लू और आउट और व्हाट वी कॉमनली नोन एज आउल इज रेफर्ड एज फुलिश और स्टूपिड, बट इफ यू स्टडी आउल्स यू विल नो दैट आउल्स आर वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इंटेलिजेंट स्पीशीज ऑन द प्लैनेट। Our first speaker for the day has conducted over a decade-long research on owls and dragonflies. Dr. Pankaj Kopare is a co-founder of Owl India and Dragonfly South Asia, the citizen science-fueled communities. Through these communities, he is actively involved in co-creation of knowledge by the outreach use of popular media. Dr. Pankaj is an evolutionary ecologist, mainly driven by his interest in biodiversity, conservation, and sustainability. He is a TEDx speaker, a Prakriti Fellow, IUCN contributor, and published Marathi writer. He was featured as SUVS Magazine's Top 10 Rising Stars of Conservation in India. To further extend his interest in education, he has been associated with the Faculty of Social Innovation, Partnership, Co-Creation, MIT World Peace University, Pune, as an assistant professor. Today, he will be talking about the urban night lifescapes and the secret lives of nocturnal animals. Let me take this opportunity to welcome Dr. Pankaj for his talk.
So since we are going to talk on nightscape or the night light, I want you to experience what a night in forest sounds like. So we are going to take a small journey from Mumbai to outskirts of Mumbai, okay? So we want all the lights, even this light should go off. Okay. विकराल मग तू शांतशी रडताना तुझा पदरही सोडला. कॅन वी हॅव द लाईट प्लीज. सो दॅट्स टिपिकली वॉट वी फाईंड वेन वी गो आउट इन द फॉरेस्ट अट नाईट. वेल यू डोंट सी एनिथिंग राईट, बट यू कॅन हिअर अ लॉट मेनी थिंग्स. अँड दीज वर ऑल द आउल्स दॅट आय एम गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट. हाऊ मेनी स्पीशीज वर देअर इन दॅट साऊंडस्केप कॅन यू टेल मी? सेवन एट. ओके, विल ट्राय टू फिगर आउट हाऊ मेनी स्पीशीज वर देअर. सो इन टुडेज टॉक आय विल बी मेनली कवरिंग दीज फोर आस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ नाईटस्केप. द सिग्निफिकन्स ऑफ डार्कनेस, वाय डार्कनेस इज व्हेरी इम्पॉर्टंट जस्ट लाईक द डे टाईम फॉर अॅनिमल्स. द सिक्रेट लाईव्हज ऑफ नॉक्टर्नल अॅनिमल्स, वॉट दे डू अट नाईट टाईम. द अर्बन नाईटस्केप, वॉट वी हॅव इन द सिटीज अँड वॉट वी डोंट हॅव इन द यु नो फॉरेस्टेड लँडस्केप. अँड द कन्क्लुजन ऑफ द टॉक. सो द चॅप्टर वन इज ऑल अबाउट इव्होल्युशन अँड क्रोनोबायोलॉजी. सो इव्होल्युशन इज रिअली अन इम्पॉर्टंट टॉपिक वेन यू टॉक अबाउट अॅनिमल्स or our cells in general, but we generally don't talk about evolution. We don't really, you know, go back in time and think about how we are all together here, why we are all together here. Okay, what is the, how is this genesis has worked throughout these millions of years of evolution? But if you could try to find out how this everything, you know, fits in the evolutionary time scale, then you will try to understand that the kind of destruction that we are doing today to this planet is something which is, I would say, very foolish. And that's just because we don't really appreciate the systems, we don't really understand how this all game has worked out. So I want you to go back in time, and this is a time of not just 10 or 20 years or 50 years, this is a billions of years of time scale since when the Earth, you know, began as a planet. Around 4.5 billions of years ago. And then eventually life appeared on the planet because of, you know, certain chemical reactions. That was around 3.5 billions of years ago. And then you can see here that the prokaryotic life forms, or the simplest form of life, originated at the same time. And then there was evolution of oxygen. Oxygen got available due to, again, certain chemical reactions. And these chemical reactions happen because of a cycle of day and night. Because you know the daytime is generally a warm period and the night times are colder periods. So there is a temperature difference. And temperature and rainfall is what drives this world. So this whole world you can categorize only on two axes, a rainfall axis and a temperature axis. So everything basically sets up when you talk about temperature. And the day and night play a major role, you know, in setting up the cycles of temperature. So warm periods are better for, you know, activities, and the cold periods is when you should sleep or you should take rest. Because if you are active at nights, at colder areas, in colder periods, then you need to spend a lot of energy just to keep your body warm. You know, that's how this logic works out. So let's just forget about this whole time scale. Let's look at the reptiles, the dinosaurs, one of the most glorified reptiles that we know of, dinosaurs. And probably this generation has already gone through the movies called Jurassic Park, Jurassic World. There have been so many movies. And we all know that dinosaurs are extinct now. They are not around. And they were some of the biggest of, you know, animals that we had. Okay, am I audible to you all?
Yes.
I don't want to get constrained to that. So the dinosaurs are not around and they are extinct, and there are reasons to, you know, say that. But after, beyond dinosaurs, we have evolution of, you know, other animals, the smaller reptiles. We have amphibians and mammals, and then flowers and bees, of course, at the end. But where do we come? We are mammals, right? We came somewhere here around 2 million years back. This line basically indicates this. Ardipithecus ramidicus was one of the primitive, you know, human-like ape. So this was 2 million years back. And Homo sapiens, our species, we originated around 2 lakh years back. So in this whole time scale, we don't really find our place.
we are so recent as compared to the whole world. And that's why probably because of that too, we don't really appreciate this whole process. Because it's so easy for us. Everything was available for us when we arrived on Earth. Of course, we had our struggle, but that's a different thing. So if you crunch this whole billions of years of time scale in just a 24-hour clock, that's how it would look like. And I'm compressing the whole time scale in 24 hours. So where we are at this point, the first humans, 11 hours, 59 minutes, 40 seconds. So we arrived on the planet just 20 seconds back in a 24-hour cycle. And that's something that we have to understand, that before we arrived, there have been so many life forms living on the planet, competing with each other, and they have created their own niches. They have been following the day and time schedule, day and night schedule, and so on. So around 1.5 million years ago, we invented fire. And that's when basically the concept of night light would come in picture. Naturally, there are forest fires, but they are happening rarely or sometimes, opportunistically. This is not a regular event. But when we control fire, we could do many things. Because then our daytime increased. We could use the light to go out and explore and so on. So we ourselves basically, motivated the control of fire. And now we know that we are just here on just 20 seconds in the 24-hour clock. And within this 20 seconds, we have destroyed our 77% of land and 87% of the oceanic ecosystems. These have been altered. So original ecosystems are not existing today. Well, I mean, that's how one species can dominate the whole planet and, completely destroy the planet. Well, that's one part of the story. But let's look at how the night light would really affect us. But before going there, let me tell you that what we are doing has happened before. What we are doing today has happened over a millions of years of time scale. So again, let's go back. So this is where we are. This is zero. This is where we are. So we just, go back in time again to 600 millions of years. And on the y-axis, you have this number of families. Or let's just assume for simplistic purpose, number of species. Okay? On the y-axis, you have number of species which are living together. There have been events given, shown by these arrows, these big arrows, where a lot many species died. For instance, here, here, and here. So you can see those tropes. Many species died at these, at these points of the time. And this could have happened because of several reasons, like climatic changes happening, or probably an asteroid coming and a meteoroid coming and crashing with the Earth, and then climatic fluctuations which are happening as a result of them, and so on. So this is where the last arrow is where the extinction of dinosaurs happened. And that is something which we all know of, right? There are many theories available, there are many animations available, so we know this about this part very well. But what is happening at that zeroth time scale is something called sixth mass extinction. So these are mass extinctions because in a very short period of time, a lot of fauna get destroyed because of several reasons. So we have already entered into the sixth mass extinction, and that's just horrible. So this era is called Anthropocene. It's a human-dominated era. And of course, it's human-dominated because our populations are huge. We are building up environment. We are recreating the environment. And you can see here, just if you do a International Union of Conservation of Nature's assessment, if you open up, then you'll find out that around 25% of all the living mammals are endangered. They are near to extinction. And similarly for birds and amphibians, you have these trends. And these are huge numbers we are talking about. Because in a very short period of time, you have many species which could go extinct if the trends continue. And in fact, this has been scientifically proven. So look at this very interesting graph. This was published in Nature, I guess. So this is just a time scale of just few hundreds of years, starting from 1500 to 2014. on the x-axis, and on the y-axis you have, let's say, the number of extinctions. So this background line, it indicates naturally how species will go extinct. If there are no humans on the planet, naturally how the species would have gone extinct. That background rate is nothing but one species per millions of years. So if you take all the birds in the world, if there are million birds, then one species will go extinct every year. That is how the, you know, this background rate is. Well, since 1700s, we have shot it up and much higher. So mammals and birds, they are the, you know, primary targets, followed by other vertebrates together and vertebrates together. Because mammals and birds are ones which are traded, which are killed, and you know, which are requiring more space, which we don't give them. Space either geographically or in time, day and night, both together. And why this happens is because this was the time when colonization started. The world started exploring the other worlds, and also the Industrial Revolution started around 1700, 1800 onwards. So this is the time when we have lost a lot of species, our colleagues on the same planet, and that's why we have entered into the sixth mass extinction, and it is horrible. The side effect of this is climatic fluctuations, global warming, and that is something that we are all suffering from. So we live in a really unhappy world as such, I would say. So how does this day and night cycle affect us? We have a circadian rhythm. Many of us are active during day and we sleep at night. That's how our work life is, basically. So even if you want to be awake at night, you can't, because you have next day you have to go to work, right? So that's typically how a normal person's sleep cycle would look like. And because of this sleep cycle, you have the energy and freshness to carry on your work next day. If you don't, let's say if you are deprived of sleep for one day, it reflects on your performance in the next day. It's very obvious. You feel tired, you can't concentrate, you need lot many coffees, you know, lot many mugs of coffees. Continue doing that. If you don't sleep for two consecutive days, there are severe side effects and so on. In fact, there are people who have, you know, challenged, you know, like, you know, these teens, they do this a lot. They challenge, and you know, one of the teens basically died of not sleeping for 48 hours straight. So not having sleep or not having the resting time in the dark period of the day could really affect your body. It can increase the stress level, it can completely mess up with the hormonal functioning of your body. Well, this one hormone called melatonin, it gets activated only at the night time. When there is darkness, the melatonin gets activated. And melatonin is responsible for the for inducing the sleep. If you don't have melatonin concentration, if you don't have enough melatonin concentration in your body, then you may suffer of insomnia. Okay, sleepless nights. Okay, that may only happen if melatonin concentration is low or you are in love. So just reducing the tension here. So that may happen, right? So this is typically how this is a graph of Mumbai people. And if you look at the same graph of Pune people, you will find two peaks of melatonin concentration. One around 1 to 4 p.m. in the afternoon. Yeah. And of course at the night time, yeah. Yeah, so basically, we are all in a rhythm. We are all in a sync. All the life they have basically got these duties. Okay, so we are active at daytime. We are diurnal animals because our ancestors were diurnal, and this has happened since 2 million of years of time. Okay, because there was no fire in the beginning, so we couldn't use fire. We didn't have any means of lightening up our world, and that's why our ancestor, they basically fit in that whole duty of morning 9 to 5, whatever, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. or even earlier of that. So that's how our circadian clock is set up. This is our biological clock. Just like we have this biological clock, many other animals would have similar biological clocks. In fact, every animal fits in this whole time scale properly. In the 24-hour cycle, everyone has a shift. For example, some animals, they are active at night times. So they are called nocturnal animals. The ones which are active at daytime, they're called diurnal animals. So we are diurnal animals, just like this guy here. And some animals, they like only dawn and dusk, low light zones. So these are called crepuscular animals. So we have a diurnal animal, we have a crepuscular animal like a hare or rabbit. Nocturnal animals are like bats and owls and so on. And some animals, they are active throughout the day and night. They are called metaturnal animals. So since it's an otter and otter lives in water, and you know the water's temperature changes very differently as compared to the land's temperature. So otters can really find out their comfortable temperature either day or in night. So that's typically how this photoperiodism in animals works out. So you would say that, okay, sir, the many of these animals should be diurnal animals because, you know, daytime looks like a warm period, so many animals should be active at that. So globally, if you do an analysis, you'll find that 100% of bat species are all nocturnal. All the bats in the world are nocturnal, and that's a huge number. Now, what do bats feed on? Bats feed on either fruits or insects. So it means insects have to be there when bats are there. So again, invertebrates or insects, you see around 70% of insects are nocturnal. Many of the insects are nocturnal. Amphibian species, again, there is a huge proportion of amphibian species. For instance, frogs and toads and so on. And even mammals, you know, 70% of mammals are nocturnal. So in fact, you will find that many of these species are finding night as a comfortable zone of activity rather than being active at daytime. And this has again happened because of an evolutionary time scale. They have found their niches. It's basically like sharing a landscape. Okay. So for instance, you have, let's say 1 square kilometer of land. And then if there is only one person, then the land will be allocated as 1 square kilometer per person, isn't it? But if there are hundreds of them, if there are 100 people, then it will get, each person will get very little amount of land. There could be fights. Those who are dominating, they can get more land. Those who are not, they may leave, they may die, right? But if the resources that you are getting from the land, if people decide that, okay, 50 people will work in the daytime, so the allocation of the land for the 50 people will be much more than the allocation of land for 100 people. And the 50 people decide that, okay, we will work at the night time. So everyone gets, you know, equal benefits, higher benefits as compared to all together. That's just because segregation in the temporal scale, segregation in the time. And that's how the concept of this niche separation and temporality arrives in the mammals and the birds. So just to give an example, these are different, 5 different species of warblers, and they all like to feed on the insects which are found in the spruce tree. So this is a documented, this is a, like a very old research done in 1958. Okay, this is published. So these are from North America, these are North American warblers. So what happens is that if each of the warbler is operating throughout the tree, there is going to be competition among the species, interspecific competition. To avoid that interspecific competition, certain warblers will only, you know, operate in certain parts of the spruce tree, and other warblers will segregate it spatially. So this I'm talking about space, geographically. Similar is the concept with the time. Time is a dimension that we don't see, but it is there. We can experience it. Just like we experience the sounds of owls. Similarly, we can experience the time. We know what's happening. So similarly, birds, you know, and other mammals can also experience the time, and they can segregate themselves to fine-tune with their competitors. So that there is less competition, everyone gets benefited. And that's typically how the world should operate. But it doesn't happen in humans' case. In fact, many species have a very strong temporality. And for instance, this quail, which is also found here, it's a long-day breeder. So when I say long day, it means short nights, right? And when I say short day, it means long nights. So again, there is a temperature difference when you say long day or short nights. So the quails will only breed during the summer time, which are the long days. And the sheep would breed only during the winter time. So even in an annual cycle, they have these, you know, segregation in the time, which we don't really understand. So there has been a lot of, you know, compartmentalization of the whole landscape and the time together. And everyone fits in this whole jigsaw puzzle of life. The problem is we try to take out the pieces of the jigsaw puzzle, and that's why we don't see the whole picture properly. And the jigsaw puzzle has been fixed through certain natural forces of, you know, natural selection, sexual selection, so on, and which has operated over a millions of years of time. So that whole concept, we as a species or a human, the most intelligent species on the planet, we don't really appreciate that, or we don't really understand it. What we see is the short-term benefits, short-term, you know, goals. We have short-term targets. Okay, in the next 10 years, probably I'll have these things. We will enhance, you know, biodiversity of particular insect or whatever bird or so on. We don't really understand how this whole interplay works. So that's typically how the days and nights cycle would, you know, play around with the breeding and the daily cycles of animals. So to sum up, the dark period is really important. It's highly significant, especially for normal functioning of plants and animals. I'm sure we have a botanist who will talk on how the dark period affects plants. And we also have a moth lady coming and talking about how it affects insects. So you'll have more insights when they talk. As I said, the day length would influence the reproductive behavior of many animals, especially the nocturnal ones. And it can also mess up with their migration, you know, period. That we'll see in the next few slides. Since if it affects the animals and birds and so on and plants, it also reflects in the maintenance of ecosystem. It's how it is connected to the ecosystems. And of course, that's how, if ecosystems are maintained, then you have minimal of global warming and climate change. If ecosystems are disrupted, you have more of that. And for us, of course, the normal physiology and life expectancy, if we have, you know, at least 8 hours of night. Okay, so this is how the this dark period would matter for everyone. So let's move on to the second chapter, and I'm sure that many of you are here to listen about the secret lives of nocturnal animals. So just like we have, they also have nightlife, and theirs, I would say, is much impressive than ours, because we say nightlife and we go to a disco and then there are these crazy lights and, you know, we dance, so we are again in the night, again in the lights, but not actually experiencing the night. Well, owls. So just now you heard about 6 species of owls, not 7 and 8, that was a good guess, but some of the owls were repetitive. So it's basically, if you go deep in the forest at night, and if there is no natural, you know, lights, you can actually hear lot many species, and it is just mesmerizing. So whenever we go to the field work and we take you know, some extra time from our schedule and then just go out. So I used to go out at 2 a.m. at night and used to sit near a lake shore or something like that, some vantage point from where I can hear all the owls. And it is just amazing. I mean, you should experience it yourself, to go in the forest and really listen to them. So we have 34 species of owls, and they all look weird, I know. Well, I did my PhD on one of these owls. This is called forest owlet. And I was lucky because this owl is active at daytime. But just to work more, I also put in the spotted owl and then jungle owlet, few more owls which are active at night time. So I was basically working almost 24 hours. So these were some of the owls which are the forest dwellers, which you will find deep in the forest. And these are also the owls which we heard about just now. So the screech-like sound, that was by this devil, spot-billed eagle owl. And this that was this brown hawk owl. In fact, its scientific name is Bubuk. because it does boo, boo, like that. And this Oriental Scope Soul, it is more melodious. So earlier, Samsung smartphones had this keypad note. So this Scope Soul has, you know, that kind of voice. And those that sound was inspired by Scope Soul's call. And our urban dwellers are the barn owl, spotted owl, and mortal wood owl. So I hope you might have seen these two. These might be there in this campus itself. But they are active at night, so you have to go out at night and, you know, see them. This is a beautifully white-colored owl. And you can't miss it when it is, you know, flying in the black, on the background of black night. Spotted owlets are sort of more noisy. The very first sound that you heard, kick, 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 that was spotted owlet. So it's very noisy. And mottled wood owl was, again, another elegant species endemic to India. So it's only found in India, nowhere else. And it's, if you look at it very closely, it looks really beautiful. And it's a huge owl. So huge owls require, so this one and this one is a huge owl. This one is a small owl. So huge owls require, you know, bigger tree trunks and so on for their nesting. But this guy, the barn owl, can actually fit in buildings, crevices and so on. So they have adapted to the urban environment much better than these guys. These are found in urban gardens, mostly. Spotted owlets don't really require much of a space. They are just like common myna. So even small holes would work for them very well. So these are the these are your colleagues in the urban landscape. So before, and owls can do some really crazy things. And by crazy, I mean this. Can you make sense out of this? I mean, I have experienced this a lot during field work. So I worked on four species of owls, and I used to, you know, trap them and catch them for blood collection. And I used to also lay around with them. So I used to catch them and just turn them around, and they will always be looking at me. That's because they have this very flexible neck joint, and they can move their neck 270 degrees. So this guy is basically, is not like this, he is like that. And they also have these ears slightly differently positioned. So one ear is slightly upper and the second ear is slightly lower. So that's one thing. Secondly, they have a really nice pair of eyes, which are very light sensitive. So they have these three sensors, two ears and a pair of eyes. So just like our GPS signal requires three satellites and you get the, you know, the best signal. Similarly, these sensors, if they are in sync, they can lock the target. And then they rely on these sensors and catch the prey. So they use the night cover very, very well, very efficiently. But if there are urban lights, and if there is urban noise, that can really hamper with their whole, you know, this predation behavior. In fact, when they fly, you won't really understand that they're flying, because they don't make any sound. So these are all the qualities that they have got through this whole process of evolution. It didn't happen over the night. It has happened over the period of time, and that's so millions of years of time. So the baby barn owls don't really look nice. I mean, even recently on internet, there was this picture of baby barn owls like this, and people were saying they found aliens. But they were baby barn owls, which people found out later. But the adult looks really majestic. So I want to show you a video so that you can appreciate this more.
Good girl.
And all this trapped in
here. Yeah. Oh, jeez. Mo.
Now, it's Kenza's turn.
No, no, no.
Jimmy.
Shh.
Jerry.
Wow, that was pretty good.
No, nothing at all. Absolutely quiet.
It's amazing.
But what have the microphones picked up? The decibel waveforms show the sound being generated by the birds in flight. Each spike is an individual wing beat. With the barn owl, there's almost nothing.
Yeah.
Even our array of super-sensitive microphones fail to pick up any sound of Kenza in flight.
And here's the owl doing exactly the same. Nothing. Nothing at all. I'll play it again. There's not a sound.
Yes.
That is really impressive, yeah. Isn't it? It shows that they really are silent flyers.
So how does a barn owl fly so silently? When air moves, it generates sound. Greater the sound. The pigeon's large body and small wings mean it can't stay airborne without a lot of fast flapping. This creates turbulence in the feathers below. The peregrine has much larger wings, which it uses to build up speed and chase down its prey. The barn owl is far more graceful. Kenza's large wings and small body make it easier for her to generate lift. So just one gentle wing beat sees her gliding effortlessly through the air, creating little more than a whisper in the feathers below.
Yeah, so that's also one of the crazy things the owls can do. Owls are sacrificed in India during Diwali period. And we know that owls are considered as Vahana of Lakshmi, goddess Lakshmi. And people think that if you kill an owl that you get a lot of money. It didn't happen because I did my PhD on owls for 5 years and it doesn't work. Owls are also killed by rodenticides a lot. And in fact, owls control the population of rats. So that's a very strong ecosystem service that they provide. If you convert that to money that you spend on rodenticide, and of course, you know, the impact the rodenticides would have on your crops and your health, because it gets, you know, the contaminated crop you eat. So if you calculate that whole cost, it would come around $1 million every year for each owl. If you kill one owl, then you are losing millions of, you know, dollars every year. So that's just why owls are important in the ecosystem. Well, the second taxa is the fireflies, and probably some of you might have gone to these firefly festivals to watch fireflies in the forest, and the photographs look really beautiful. So these are the ones which attract many people to go and have a look at fireflies. But the problem with this is that we are in the ecological Armageddon right now. So there has been a 75% decline in last 25 years in insect population. you might have experienced this already, that, you know, a few years back, if you turn a porch light, then many insects would fly into it, but now nothing, right? And that basically reflects how we have degraded the ecosystems around us. If these insects are not there, any insect as such, then that, you know, directly impacts on all that food cycle and the food pyramid and the energy pyramid that you're talking about. So it's basically how this degradation starts. This is a direct evidence of that. And fireflies are no exception to this. There are many commercial firefly festivals which are happening. So I would say, please don't go to those festivals. If you really want to experience fireflies, come with us. We go out in the forest, but we don't really disturb the forest as such, you know, because we don't go in a crowd. You know, probably 2-3 people walking inside the forest, that's fine. And fireflies have this very short duration of mating period. And if tourists go and watch them, they use flashlights, of course, and they use flashes for taking pictures. So that completely disrupts their mating cycle, and, you know, it affects the next generation and so on. So their population decline would again a part of the ecological Armageddon that we are talking about. And this is all scientifically proven. I'm not just, you know, giving you facts. This is the validated facts that I'm telling you. Okay, so the nightscape is also the time for dogs to come together and have group discussions. they are active at night because, you know, at daytime there is a lot of traffic, there are people around, so they don't really get privacy as such, so they come together at night. And as dogs come together, so is the dark night. So this is a picture taken from Mumbai itself. I mean, I didn't take it, but the person has been copyright has been mentioned there. So this is the leopard of Borivali, and they are everywhere. So you will find a lot of material actually available on the leopards of Mumbai, and it just we don't really understand how they operate in a highly one of the densest populated city in India. So even the top predators are around us when it's night. So quickly, the chapter 3, the urban nightscape, what happens at urban areas. And this is the satellite image showing. So this is, I think, 2017 image taken by NASA. This is a composite image. Since we know that, you know, the time periods are different. So these are stitched satellite images together. So you can see that some of the densest lights are occurring in United States and India and China. And of course, the developed part of the Europe. But the lit up areas also indicate population density, access to light, and also rich areas in the world. But if you sort of distort this map and correct it for the population, then of course, you know, India stretches. India is in the middle, you can see, after Africa, India stretches because of the population density. And over the period of time, there has been a lot of electrification throughout the landscape of India, which basically looks something like this. So since 1995 to 2013, you can see the intensification of nightlight in many areas of India. So in fact, we are one of the leading, you know, countries which has been electrified in the last few years. And if you compare India with other countries, then the red line is India. And of course, we are still, I mean, we are not 100% electrified. That's in a way good, but and that's how the progress is basically measured. So this is the world data. Okay, so let's move on to the last topic of the talk, the dark face of nightlight. Nightlight, you know, from a distance looks really nice. You can take good pictures. You have so many colors in it, the shades of blue and so on. So what is it that that we should, you know, worry about when you talk about nightlight? You can see in this image, if you go from intercity sky to the excellent dark sky, you can actually see the stars in the sky. So this is something called sky glow. Because of the sky glow, you can't see the stars. The night, basically the light coming from the stars is completely blocked. And these are the stars, or these are the planets that guide the migration of birds or migration of any animals as such. So these are the celestial objects which birds have been using for millions of years to navigate through. So if they don't see it, if they don't understand this whole map, then there are repercussions of this, and some of them are colliding with large high-risk towers and so on. So turtle hatchlings, they generally move towards light because their basic instinct is to go to the sea from the seashore. So generally they hatch at dawn and they follow the sun's light and they move towards the sea. But in urban areas, they may get distracted and may move towards inland, and then they lose time, they lose energy, they get predated, they may get roadkill and so on. So many turtle babies die just because of the urban light. Well, there was one study conducted on insects, these mayflies, and they swarm at night for purpose. And mayflies, they breed in the water. So what the scientists found out that on a particular road, there was a lot of swarms of the mayflies, and they all congregated it at one place. So they tried to find out why it is happening. So they basically did some analysis, and they found out that this particular area reflects a water-like signature for the mayflies. So all the mayflies think that there is water there, and that's why they might congregate there. But the end result is all of them are dead. So you see that millions of mayflies are dead just because of So this is again a study that is published. So I am basically presenting a lot of compilation of research articles. Well, the roadkill is also something that many people talk about, and light plays a major role in roadkills. So these are all the animals which are sensitive to light. And in fact, you might have observed that if someone takes a picture of yours in night using flash, then probably in 2 seconds you go blind. You don't see anything, right? So similar thing happens with the animals when they're crossing the roads. And if suddenly a fast-moving vehicle is coming and they have their upper on, then it's like a flash of light, very intense flash of light. So these animals, they look at the moving object, but they get, they get blind for a few seconds. And by the time, they are crushed already. So these are some of the, so the first picture is a very dramatic one, because that the cub was suckling to the mother, and it got hit by another car. So the mother was dead on the road, and the cub was not dead. Cub was just around the mother, but the cub got hungry and then came to the mother and tried suckling her, and then the other car came and crushed the cub. So many things would happen, and in fact even owls get killed a lot at night. So the five major disturbances to animals is, first of all, it's the lights could be disorienting the animals. So they move away from their migratory paths, they get strayed, and they sometimes go collapse into the tall high-risk buildings. The congregation may happen. For instance, all the insects would congregate to night lampposts, considering that it's a sun, there is sun energy, and the bats would go and feed on them. So there is predatory congregation happening, which is also very bad for ecosystems. Third is celibacy. Some plants, they need pollinators which are only active at night. So because of the night light pollution, those pollinators wouldn't come, and the plants can't breed. So the breeding is hampered directly. The fourth one is the algal blooms. So zooplankton, which is found in the water, it is active only at night. If there is light, then the zooplanktons do not come up on the surface of the water. Zooplanktons are the ones which feed on the algae. So if the zooplanktons don't come, then there are algal blooms. And algal blooms basically then block the sun rays, and the aquatic vegetation dies off, the fishes die off, there is eutrophication that also happens. And finally, the fifth one is stress. So continuous light, because of that, birds can't sleep or animals can't sleep. Even for us, in our bedroom, before we go to sleep, we switch off the light and then we sleep, right? So if there is continuous light, if there is some sort of activity, then you have a very stressful night. And then again, you can't focus in the next day and so on. So in case of birds and animals, it's almost every day. Every night, it's stressful. In fact, there has been a study recently that shows that many animals are preferring to go more and more nocturnal. They want to avoid the human touch. They want to avoid the human lights. So they are basically narrowing down their nocturnal niche. And you can see here there are examples from global, global level. The tiger's example, to minimize the direct encounter with the people, the tiger goes more nocturnal. So, you know, these are the kind of things. And in fact, hiking and walking, something that we think that is very non-destructive or non-invasive. You know, many people trek at night because it's less tiring. That is also one of the activities which can increase the risk factor for the animals. And animals are generally shy. They don't come out and they don't want to be in touch with humans because that's just disgusting. So they avoid humans. So, you know, even hiking and walking, which we think that is, not at all destructive for wildlife, is actually very destructive. In fact, tourism is something is very destructive. I mean, although it generates revenue for the management of the wild parks, but it has been shown to be destructive to animals and so on. So animals are going deep into the night now. They are narrowing down their niches. So what do we do? What are the options available to us? Well, we don't really have many options available because our reliance on the light is extensive. We can't avoid it. So the one thing that we can do is we can have minimalistic designs. Landscape architects or architects would know this better, how to use the sunlight maximally so that even at the dawn or dusk time, you don't need to use many lights or how to minimize the use of lights to lighten up a particular area. So minimalistic design is something that we should really think of. We can reduce the light use. So we don't really need to illuminate everything. Probably we can selectively illuminate parts of the buildings or our living space. We can use movement sensors, which is very useful because then you don't have a continuous light throughout. And porch lights we can avoid because they are more of an aesthetic purpose. So wherever there is requirement, you can put those. Reflectors can also be very handy because they don't really get illuminated. So only when the light is incident on them, they reflect back the light. So in a way, they don't really confuse the animals. And covered lights. So we don't really want the glare of the light to come out, or we don't want the sky glow kind of an event, or trespassing of light to nearby areas. For instance, now this light is just focusing on me or the on this part. So this is something very useful. We want to only light up areas which are required, not all the areas. So these are the intelligent lights and dreams. In some parts, they have used red lights. These are long wavelengths which do not distract animals because animals don't get disturbed by the long red wavelengths. So this may look very scary, but if you get used to it, just like we are used to yellow light and white light now, if you get used to the red light, probably this could also be incorporated in designs. And of course, use diaper at night. Use dipper at night. So that's something that you can use. that too. Okay, so to conclude, darkness is very essential when you talk about life in general. And there are many processes which are controlled by the dark period of the time. So sky glow or glare or light trespassing, they pose a serious risk to wildlife and humans. And this basically is killing them softly. It's not directly impacting, but these are very indirect impacts that you can think of. Light pollution acts as a slow poison. So you don't see the short-term output of it, but there is definitely a long-term output you can think of. So what we can do is reduce the light usage. Do not go to firefly festivals, please. Do not sacrifice owls. And even educate others that, owls are good omen. They are Vahana of Lakshmi. So, you need to conserve them. Please don't use rodenticide. Use an owl instead. And smart lighting technology is something that the architects can, propose and can have more discussion on it later on. So I want to show you one small video and then maybe you can finish it up.
These are research specimens of migratory birds from the Field Museum in Chicago. These are just one tray of specimens out of more than 70,000 birds that have died hitting buildings in Chicago over the past four decades. A lot of these birds died because they were attracted by artificial light emanating from buildings in Chicago. Many birds migrate at night, and for reasons that we still don't totally understand, the artificial light coming from buildings actually disorients migratory birds and attracts them and leads them to collide with buildings. They fly under the cover of darkness, and we don't see the migration.
Two south, one west. Two more south.
One of the only ways that we can actually watch migratory birds flying at night is with the use of a thermal imaging camera. This allows us to see nocturnal migration in action, but we can't tell which species are involved. Only through listening to nocturnal flight calls can we actually identify these nocturnal migrants to species and begin to learn about who is migrating when. Migratory birds, when they're flying, many of them make these very faint, subtle, high-frequency calls. So what we think is happening is that birds, when they're attracted to light, that they become disoriented and they're flying around, and we think they're actually calling more and making more nocturnal flight calls while they're flying, and that this may in fact attract more members of the same species to the light. Our study is a good example of the impact of artificial light on migratory birds. We show that the more light there is, that the more birds collide with certain buildings, and so by continuing to try to turn lights off at night when they're not needed during bird migration will help to reduce the impact of light pollution on bird mortality.
Thank you, Dr. Pankaj. A lot of things about owls, dragonflies, and urban nightlife patterns which we were not aware of and which are equally important to understand were presented. So thanks a lot for this insightful presentation.